Welcome to the Machine Learning Track, and I'm your host, Priyanka. So today's talk is about an important field of research, MLOps, how machine learning models can be seamlessly integrated, incorporated into production environments. And to deliver the talk on the topic, the state of MLOps, machine learning in production at an enterprise scale, I invite our speaker, Bash Gehring, who is a tech lead in AI and big data domain, having over a decade of experience in this field. And I invite the speaker to present his talk.
Thank you, Priyanka, and thanks for a nice introduction. Indeed, we're going to talk about MLOps. Let me share my screen to start with, so I can share some slides. Yes, here we are. MLOps is, of course, machine learning operations. The practice of putting machine learning models in production. A lot of companies are struggling with that at the moment. So I hope to give you a bit of an overview of what it is, why you need it, and maybe give you some best practices and some guidance on this. A bit about myself. My name is Bas Gehring. I live in the Netherlands. I'm an independent consultant, and I have my own background is AI, artificial intelligence. And yeah, in the last 15 years, so I worked with data, machine learning, et cetera, et cetera. And you can find me, of course, on Twitter, LinkedIn, et cetera. We'll be happy to connect. I co-authored a couple of books recently. So if you find this kind of topic interesting, then there's two books available that I did my share in, so to say. One is the Artificial Intelligence Workshop. It's a technical book by Pact. And the other one is an O'Reilly book called 97 Things Every Data Engineer Should Know. So, of course, these books are highly recommended. Let's start a bit with the basics. And I'll talk a few minutes about what we're actually talking about. Setting the stage about the AI hype and machine learning itself. What are you actually talking about? Machine learning is sometimes considered to be like a bit vague, and sometimes people think it's a bit scary even. But if you look at the core difference, it's not even that special. And so I just wrote the definition of Mitchell that is commonly known as the one of the best definitions in this space, and that is a computer program is set to learn from experience E with respect to some class of tasks T and performance measure P, if its performance at tasks in T, as measured by P, improves with experience E. And that, of course, is a bit scientific, but what this actually says is that a machine learning algorithm is an algorithm that just learns from historical data. There's nothing fancy or scary about this yet. It's just some algorithm that can be as simple as a multiplication or a rule-based system even, that just takes historical data, processes it, and gives a recommendation about new data. And machine learning is even not new. In the 1950s and 60s, we already had a lot of machine learning algorithms. That the most commonly used algorithms, such as neural networks, which is now evolved into deep learning, have already been designed and programmed in the 60s. Back then, the amount of data that we had and the amount of processing power was just not enough to use those kind of complex algorithms in business organizations. But nowadays, that is the case. So you see machine learning everywhere. Most of the examples are from the big companies like Netflix, Google, etc. But also, it's becoming so mainstream now that smaller companies and governments, etc., are also able to use machine learning models on their data to make recommendations, predictions, etc., about their data. And it's just proven to be extremely useful because these kind of algorithms can predict and make recommendations, etc., that are just not possible with traditional rule-based systems. Machine learning also comes with some complexity. There are several types of machine learning algorithms, and each type of machine learning algorithm also comes with its own specific, you know, frameworks and tools. But you have to remember that every single piece of every one of these is just follows the same pattern. It takes historical data, as we saw in the definition, learns from that historical data, and makes a recommendation on new data. So what is if you look at all this complexity, what are people usually doing when they are starting to work with machine learning, when they are starting to, you know, do AI even, right? And I'm talking about students or people maybe who have a big background as software engineers. They work with this, and what you see here is an example of a notebook. And that's great, because this is a great tool to build machine learning algorithms. And why is this so great, so nice to work with? Notebooks are really good in giving direct feedback while you're programming and while you're building and training your model, because you can easily visualize what you're working with. You can see the tables of data, you can display graphs right in your browser without having to do all kind of complex things like installing tools, working with big data, doing extensive testing, etc. But this is not production-ready code. This is only just the beginning. So that's an important realization, that if you are doing machine learning, if you're a data scientist, then working with notebooks is just a means to an end, and it's actually only the starting point of putting a real model live in production. And a famous paper about this was written a few years ago by some people from Google, where they visualized what is coming to the table when you actually want to productionize a machine learning model. This little black box in the middle is the machine learning code. That is the only that little, you know, black box is what we just saw in the previous pictures, with all the complexity of the machine learning models that are inside of it, and which can be the result of, for example, a notebook, which is like a trained model. But all the rest around that should not be forgotten, and that actually would take probably more time and more complexity and more resources, maybe even money and etc., to do right and to do correctly. So this is actually what machine learning operations, MLOps, is all about. So let's look a bit on what this is, MLOps. If you want to, so let's say you have a data scientist, you have trained a machine learning model, it makes a nice prediction about the future, and you want to put this in production. And first I want to take a step back to another paradigm, another best practice. This is called DevOps. And this is something that was that became mainstream like 10 years ago. It was actually a movement that was evolving hand in hand with the agile movement when we were doing like Scrum, etc. And DevOps means that we were moving into a situation where teams were being restructured. So instead of having teams that were dedicated on software development and teams that were dedicated on operations, on maintenance of those, of the software, of the code, we said, hey, let's combine them in one place, in one team. And so DevOps was all about teams and about people, about working together and about being agile. And that was a very successful movement, because now suddenly there were no complex handovers between development and operations teams or departments even. But it was like, hey, we are working together. We have one shared common goal in our DevOps team. And that came together with practices such as continuous integration delivery, where you can do frequent releases of your code, like on a daily basis, for example, if you want that. And that makes it much more robust and much more scalable and much easier to correct and to test, etc., your software. And all these kind of practices are actually can also be applied to machine learning models. But then something else comes into play, And that is the machine learning algorithm, of course. So I tried to visualize it a bit with this really nice Venn diagram. I of course had to include a Venn diagram. You see on top, you see the DevOps boxes, the circles still there, like in the DevOps organization. But I just added the machine learning circle here. And that means that we have another specialty, another flavor, another type of research people, like data scientists, added to the bunch. But actually, I really believe that they should be cooperating in the same way as DevOps people are doing. And that means that they should share, they should be in one multidisciplinary team together. They should share the same goal in that team. They should, you know, inform each other on a regular basis, on a daily basis, what they're doing. They should also be looking together at problems that might arise, if, for example, the model's not performing well, or if the data is not being prepared in the right way, etc. It's all about this kind of cooperation. And that is what, for me, is one of the key ideas about MLOps. It's not about tooling, etc. We'll talk about that later, but that comes later. First, you have to realize that this is what it's about, why this is important. And this, of course, the number of roles and responsibilities will grow a little bit, like comparing to when you would just develop, let's say, microservice, you would, you don't need machine learning capabilities. So you probably need some people like machine learning engineers that have the responsibility of integrating the model and serving the model, and maybe some data engineers that do the data preparation, the ETL process, before your data can actually be used as features in your model. But it doesn't have to be new people on the team. It can also be existing people as software engineers that just take up the responsibilities that come with, like, a machine learning engineer. The data scientists is what I see are typically still very specialized people with data science or mathematics background that are focusing on building and training the model itself. And I want to show one other picture, because this whole idea of multidisciplinary teams is also not new. It's called the Spotify model. That's already been discussed lots of times, where these kind of people, these kind of roles, are being combined in one squad. That's a team, and the squads have common goals. But then you can introduce some other form of, like, organizational structures, like tribes and chapters, to make sure that your people are up with the new standards and working together on shared services. So, summarize this a bit. What is the goals of MLOps? Well, in my view, MLOps brings the philosophy of DevOps to the data science community, adding data science to what we already do with development operations, to gain trust, to be able to release frequently, continuous delivery, correct and test frequently, etc., and to gain speed. Because if you do this and combine people with these kind of roles and responsibilities in one team, you will actually become much faster in building and releasing software that includes a machine learning model. Some best practices about this. And we'll come to technical parts a bit now. Because how do you do this? I have not talked about any tooling or technology yet. First of all, what is a good realization is that the product of a data scientist, so what will be created when he is working with notebooks, for example, if he does that, is just a file. So this machine algorithm should be just considered a file with a certain life cycle. That's just an asset in your software architecture, like you might have other assets as well. Like you might have pictures or sound files or something if you're developing an app, for example. That means that you have to do proper management on that, proper life cycle management, by versioning that, by assigning the right metadata, by giving it a proper location, by having it in a stable place. And also by continuously testing and monitoring what is live in production. So that's also what you normally do with any other piece of software. Once it's live, you start monitoring it, and you start checking if it's still performing well, if the latency is low enough, etc. But that's also the same thing as you do with your models. But then something interesting should be done. That is not just focusing on the technical monitoring, the infrastructure, like saying, okay, is my network still balanced? Is my CPU level not 90% or something like that? That's also very important. But you should also look at the business metrics. And by that is like checking if your model is not predicting any strange values. Because let's say if you have a model in production that predicts delivery times of for a web shop, right? So the time it takes to get a package to a customer, that on average that should be probably a few days. If suddenly after deploying a new model or after a few days of deploying a new model, that value goes up or down with 50% on average, something might be wrong, and data drift could actually be happening, which means that the data your model's been trained on is very different from the actual data that is currently in production, because maybe situation has changed, customer behavior has changed. It could be an event in your web shop that suddenly has had different characteristics than the data your model was trained on. So that's a few realizations you have to make. Let's look a bit at the architecture, how to set this up. I tried to create a picture with the most high level abstract reference architecture kind of view that I could think of, and this is what I came up with. It's a bit oversimplified, but I think it's good to talk this over, because what I described here is how to run a model in production. And there's two parts. There's a real time part, the top layer, and a batch part, the bottom layer. So first of all, let's start with the batch part, the bottom layer. The goal of the batch pipeline basically is to build and train a machine learning model that is ready to be picked up by the real time pipeline, by the top part. And how does that work? Usually there is a model training job. So that could be an Airflow job, or it could be just a cron job that picks up data from a feature store that is data that has been collected while the model was live in production, picks up the data, let's say the last month of data or something like that, or last year, and retrains the model on that data to produce a new version of the model. The model is then stored in a model repository. And that is a database again, but it can be as simple as a file share, where all these metadata that I mentioned before is being applied to. So this should be properly versioned. It should be, there should be a location that's easily retrievable. It should be accessible. There should be some governance around that, etc. And if this process happens automatically, let's say you do a batch every day because you want to retrain your model every day, then this can of course be automatically being done. But what you also see is that in many cases this batch is done manually only when people are certain that the data has diverted so much that a new model is needed for training. Of course, if the model itself changes, so the input features, for example, change of the model, or the algorithm that we use to build the machine learning model changes, then this pipeline also has to be kicked off, because then your whole model will be renewed. There will not be just a new version of the existing model that has been trained on new data, but the entire model will be different. And then you can, if you have this kind of changes, then you can work with a new major version. So what I usually do is I have a major and a minor version of the model. Major version is, for example, version 4 or 5, and then iterations of that model, like retraining of that model on the same on new data, is then version 4.1, 4.2, etc. You can of course assign timestamps to that, etc., whatever you want. So once the model is retrained and stored in a model repository, it can be picked up by the real-time pipeline. And it can be done by deploying a new version of that pipeline. That's usually what happens. Or it can also be done on runtime if you would build such a, you know, such a mechanism for that. And that model is usually being wrapped in a component in your architecture. It can be wrapped in, like a monolithic kind of structure, like a full app, or a whole the back end of a website. That's perfectly possible. That can contain an asset. Remember that the models are just files, so the model files can be just incorporated in those kind of big monolithic structures, and being used from that. But that's not really a best practice. It's better to API-ify your model a bit in the microservices kind of way. So to create a small wrapping layer around your model that just accepts the input data, scores the model, so that executes the model, gets a prediction from the model, and then publishes the results to whoever was requesting that prediction. So this API, this orange box that I drew here, this API is just that. It's just a wrapper around one machine learning model that takes input and produces the output there. That has to be fed by data. So there's usually a data preparation step before that. Maybe again another microservice that prepares the data that's coming from, for example, a website or coming from customer input, to be able to provide it to the model. One thing here I want to mention here is that this data preparation can be quite complex. Don't underestimate that, the size of this box, so to say, because this data preparation can also actually include, again, data from a feature store, for example. Once you have features that are aggregated, calculated based on historical data, let's say you want to have an average number of something, the average amount of sales, the average amount of clicks that a customer made, or something like that. It has to be that you cannot calculate that in real time, because that's just too slow. And that query, that calculation, would probably take up a few seconds, which is way too slow to do that on every request. So what you usually want to do is get that data, is prepare the data, store it in a feature store, and inject it once when you need it, maybe even cache it in your data preparation step. And usually there's also, so after the scoring has been done, there's also some post-processing going on. And that is usually interpreting the result of the model and producing a follow-up action. Let's say, so that's maybe display something on a website, you're giving a prediction, giving a recommendation, et cetera, because the model score itself is meaningless, usually. A typical machine learning model gives a score, let's say, from 0 to 1. So the score is 0.67. Yeah, what does that mean? There has to be some interpretation and some post-processing to make sense of that score. So this is the high-level structure that you usually see. Then you can go further in this. So, for example, if you would like to apply online learning, you could say, "Hey, I have a batch job here. This model and this is fed on the data on a feature store. This data is collected while the service is running. Why don't we retrain the model while the data is coming in?" So there's not a batch job anymore. There's almost a continuous retraining of my machine learning model. That's what we call online learning. That's actually a practice that you don't see that often yet, but that is what you can do, of course. If it's very important for your business that you have a model that is trained on the latest data, on the latest customer behavior, then you should actually schedule this batch to be, you know, running every minute or so, or with every piece of data that arrives. So, you know, so there's extensions to this framework, but I think you get the idea of this real-time versus batch pipelines. Now, if you look at an example of a real architecture or concrete architecture, is this one. I currently work at this company called Wayfair. It's a retail organization that sells furniture and other home goods. And we implement this architecture in this way. So you also see some examples of some tooling that we use for this and some infrastructure here. But you can actually see that, you know, the real-time pipeline is actually working in this way. There's an API that runs on Kubernetes, gets the model from the model repository. The model gets there by an Airflow job that is run in our case every week on a weekly basis. We retrain the model and that model again gets the features from BigQuery where they are stored while the customers are going about on the website. Also, other architectures and I'm not going to go through all of them, but I just want to give some examples. Google Cloud, Microsoft Azure, and Amazon AWS, they all produced reference architectures for machine learning pipelines. And in every one of them, you will see the same pattern. You'll see that, okay, there's a batch job process that produces your model, stores it in some location, that picks up from that location in a component, like for example the model serving component you see here in the Google Cloud, and that is used in real time with an API or in any kind of service that runs real time. Same here. There's a batch job here that trains the model, publishes the data to a service that is being run on real time in Azure. And of course, Microsoft gives the examples of the tooling that they have designed and built for this. Yeah, Azure, Microsoft will not give you the examples of other tools that you could use. They want to promote their own tooling. But the principles are the same. Also in Amazon, this is the exact same pattern that you see. So now we come to the end, and that is the tooling. So I put this in the end on purpose, because if you would Google for MLOps, machine learning, how do you do it in production, the first thing you'll probably end up with is tooling, because you'll see some tools of this landscape, and there's only a small diagram, I think, that I just Googled and found myself. And lots of companies that explain how to do it, how to put your machine learning model in production, how to retrain your model, how to automatically visualize and prevent data drift, and et cetera, et cetera. And that's all great. And I mean, these tools are very good, and they're all under development, and they're all being used by many organizations. So, but most importantly, before you actually start using these tools and start diving in this kind of landscape, this kind of diagrams, first ask yourself these kind of questions. Do you want to accomplish with this tooling? Yeah, what fits my organization? What kind of tool do you actually need? You might go for a vendor product that has a license, or you might go for an open source product. You might go for one solution that has everything in it. Yeah? You know, this whole architecture is just wrapped, captured in one tool. Or you might want to say, okay, now I want to have a specific tool for only model serving, one for model training, one for the feature store, et cetera, et cetera. That's the most important decisions that you have to make. You might want to build your own tooling sometimes. Sometimes the tool is just a simple script. Yeah, you can start with simple scripts to publish a model or to get it from a repository or something like that. Yeah, but the important thing is to realize that there is lots of tooling, rather than blindly following what a vendor or an open source community says. Think about first what fits my organization. So some details about the tooling that I want to go into, and I already explained a bit of this. And first, this box here, this model scoring box. There's lots of tools available that you can use to say, okay, I want to run my model in production. And they all come with certain pros and cons and the benefits. Some might be faster, some might be slower, some might be easy to implement, some might be better to integrate, etc. So there's all kinds of pros and cons that we'll not go into. But they all follow one of these patterns. And it's also, I think, important to realize that the way that you do your model serving, which is one of the most important things, of course, in machine learning, can be done in four main ways, basically. First of all, and again, I would not recommend this, is to deploy your model together with your application. And let's say you have a machine learning model that's a file, that's an export to a Python structure like joblib or maybe it's a piece of Spark code in ML, written in MLib. You can just package it, together with the rest of your application, together with your business logic, for example, and just have it somewhere in the back end of an application. That's possible, but it's not really recommended because it's not flexible. It's not modular in that sense. It would be very difficult to upgrade only a version, like a minor version of one model, and to properly test and deploy that in the right way. What you actually want to do is want to modularize it a bit in a microservices kind of sense. And there's a few options for that. So one of them is to have a shared service that hosts all your models together, maybe in a dedicated tool. So there's tools available on the market that have the single purpose of hosting models. And that's a great solution, because you might not have one model in production, might have 10 or 100 but then it's a nice way to say, okay, I have a dedicated tool for that, where my model runs next to other versions of the model, next to also other models. And when I need it, I'm just picking that up with a query, etc., in another piece of my architecture, like in a backend of a website. And that's being done on runtime usually. And then I can modularly upgrade it, test it, etc., replace it if I need to. Another option, which is probably even more flexible, but also comes with a bit of a cost of some maintenance, etc., is to API your model. Currently, that's what I don't mostly do, but it might be that it's maybe a bit overkill for some organization if you have, for example, many models. But that is the practice of what I already mentioned, of creating a small wrapper around your model that just accepts the input, scores the model, produces the output, and that's the single responsibility of this little gray box here, which is a microservice in itself, that's just a wrapper around the model. And that is very flexible, because then you can say, okay, hey, I want to upgrade my model, I want to upgrade my service. What if my features change? Okay, I'm just deploying my model together with my service in this sense, and I'm making sure that everything works in cooperation with the other components of my application, my business logic and my front end, etc. The one final way to serve your model is a bit of a different type of serving. It's streaming. And why would I mention this? Well, all the other methods of serving your models are are working in a kind of a microservices way, and are basically dependent on network. I think that's an important realization. If you're doing a microservice architecture, then there's always some kind of network in between your components. But that might be too slow in some cases. If you would have a very low latency requirements, low latency, high throughput streaming, yeah, so you would have thousands of messages per second, and every message, every event would have to be used in a machine learning model to get a prediction. For example, what if you want to make a prediction about every mouse click of every customer on your website, and you have a big website with thousands of concurrent users? Yeah, it might be too slow to go to a separate API and to call a service and to wait for the results, to serialize it again and to interpret it. That might also already take a few milliseconds, but might be too slow. But then there's an option to go a little bit back to the first scenario, basically, and that's to incorporate your model in your stream. So in your streaming logic, in your component that runs, for example, on Spark Structured Streaming or on Flink, you can actually integrate your model in one of the streaming jobs that run there, with specific methods that are meant to be distributable and fast. And that's a good way to build these kind of streaming systems. And there's typical export formats like PML and Onyx that can be used to build this to basically form this glue between a data science model and a data stream. So yeah, what's best for your organization? I don't know, but pick one of them that fits, yeah? and make a conscious decision about that. I think that's one of the key points for this. Yeah, a few other details about the tooling itself. In my opinion, you should Dockerize or containerize, or all the things. So rather than going with a solution on a certain cloud or on-premise infrastructure that is very tightly coupled to that infrastructure itself, I think the best tools out there run on Kubernetes nowadays. And I know this is highly opinionated. So if you disagree, then please let me know and we can have a nice chat about it. But I prefer to be flexible and prefer to have this the power of Kubernetes and Docker everywhere that I work. Yeah? So whether it is an API that's being built, whether it's a highly scalable big data solution, whether it's just a simple, load test or a small test that runs only once per day and does a very small thing, I want to work with Docker and with Kubernetes as the underlying infrastructure, because that gives me all the flexibility that I need, all the robustness that I need. It makes sure that I when I test this on a local machine or like on my laptop, I get the same results as on a testing environment or on production. Well, I'm pretty sure that a lot of people here know even more advantages of running this on Kubernetes, but this is for me very, very important. We talked about a feature store already a bit. So one last thing to mention about that is that there is dedicated tools here available now that can actually, that can store your features in a good way. I don't say you have to use them, but we are going to a situation where for every kind of scenario that is out there, including storing features, there is a kind of a specialized database for it. And I don't know if I like that, but it is the case, because there are certain requirements to storing features that you probably will not get when you are working with another database. One of the most important ones is performance. If you want to evaluate the features on real time, yeah, they should be queryable very, very quickly, and high performance database is one of the best things, of course, that you need to have. features themselves, I mentioned this already, can be in two flavors. They can be pre-computed or aggregated. For example, let's take the average amount of sales that have been happening, or the average amount of clicks per customer, something per something, right? So per, it's something per location, an average per location, account per location, or per customer, or per anything, that is an aggregated feature. And those ones should be pre-computed and stored in your feature store in a different way than the real-time features that are, the features that you get from the event data itself, for example, the URL that somebody visits, or the product that he's looking at. And a good feature store can support both of them. They can store aggregated features and real-time features, and probably we'll call them differently, but et cetera, but the principle is the same, and make sure that this is the case. All right, I'm looking at the time. I have a few minutes left. So a short wrap-up is that, we talked about MLOps, machine learning operations. We started with machine learning. I mentioned already a notebook is not machine learning yet, or it's not AI yet, or it's actually just the beginning. Yeah? It's just the exploration of data that's really good to do with notebooks, and maybe even building or training a model. But after that, of course, the goal of MLOps is to properly maintain and put that in production. How can you do that? Well, I think one of the best ways to look at it is to apply the DevOps principles, and to do continuous integration, delivery, testing, etc., on the assets that you have. And now you just have a machine learning model that comes along with that. We talked about the architecture a little bit. Remember the two pipelines that work together basically on the models. And we talked a little bit about the tooling. I mentioned dedicated tools such as feature stores. So I think that's it. I hope you learned a bit from it. If you want to know more, then here's some resources. There is, of course, my own book that I want to mention again. Then there's a few months ago, actually, there was a new Coursera specialization launched called MLOps. So that gives you some hands-on practice with this kind of tooling and architectures, and a nice website that I recommend is the mlops.org website, which contains a lot of resources and best practices again. All right, I'm looking at the time.
Hello. Yeah, we'll take a question here.
Yeah.
What approaches to link version of model and version of data or version of pre-processing algorithm or feature composing algorithm to get reproducible results and provide rollback operation possibility?
So is that a question on the Q&A?
It is on Q&A.
What approaches to link version of model and version of data or version of pre-processing algorithm to get? I don't understand the question fully, but I think the question is about how you would link versions of models and data, right?
And produce optimizable results. Yeah.
Yeah. So one thing I didn't mention is that you can also version data. Yeah? There's tools available and frameworks that are able to versionize your model. So if that is important, of course, you should use that. On the other side, a version of the code of the code that runs the model is just easily to connect to the version of the model, because it's just a piece of metadata. So once you would, for example, redeploy a new version of your API that wraps your model, you would give it a number. Let's keep it very, very simple. Just the version number of your machine learning algorithm, and once you deploy it, so at build time basically, your API will get the right version from your model repository, and use it as its model that is running in production.
Let's take a quick question again. What are your views on Kubeflow? And the second question is, what are the most common mistakes that scientists make regarding MLOps?
Yeah, the most common mistakes. I think the most common mistake is to think that, you know, once they have created a notebook, then it's done. That's of course a bit because data scientists usually work with that kind of tools. That's what they have sometimes been using for years, until they come in an enterprise and say, yeah, okay, it's great that you have created a notebook, but it's not a piece of software that is, you know, maintainable and that is productionizable. So that is the only where it begins. So
between, I'm sorry, we are running out of time. You can please approach the speaker directly through his profile, and I'll paste the link in the description. I mean, in the chat box. So lastly, I would like to end the session by thanking you, Vash, for such an informative session, and thank you, audience, for joining the ML Chat. Thank you so much.
Thank you.